Psychology is the scientific study of human behavior and thought processes. Similar to other scientists, such as astronomers who use telescopes to study stars and planets, or biologists who use microscopes to study organisms and cells, psychological scientists only study observable phenomena, such as how a person walks, how a person talks, how a person sleeps or eats. Of course, there are those internal forces that we're interested in as well, those things that are harder to observe, but we do those kinds of observations by looking at things that we can measure. So we try to learn about the inner mind by studying the body. Another thing that is common across all sciences is the use of the scientific method. You know, it has those various steps that I described in the previous video. When it comes to psychology, the scientific method refers to how psychologists acquire knowledge by observing the behavior of individuals in order to develop hypotheses regarding how the mind works. So this is that empiricism I previously described. Then they use those hypotheses to try to predict behavior under specific conditions. So this is that systematic part I was describing in the previous video. And then the third feature of science is repeatability, and psychologists accomplish this by just creating hypotheses based on their observations and then testing them repeatedly by making additional observations. But hypotheses, regardless of whether you're doing psychology or any science really, hypotheses come in two flavors. You have what are called basic hypotheses. So basic research involves research conducted primarily for the sake of achieving a more detailed and accurate understanding of human behavior. So we're not really trying to address any particular problem. We're not trying to help anybody. We're just trying to learn about how something works. For example, you might ask the question, how do babies learn how to talk? You know, it is pretty neat if you think about it, the kinds of stuff babies can do, but we don't fully understand how they do it. So that would be basic research. The other kind is called applied research, and that specifically is research conducted to address a practical problem, to try to improve the quality of life, maybe to, you know, help somebody recover from a medical condition, perhaps. Like an example of this would be, how can we better treat individuals with anxiety disorder? Trying to develop new techniques, new methods to assist these individuals in their recovery. So some researchers tend to prefer more basic kind of stuff. You know, they're just curious about the world and humans and how everything works. Whereas other researchers set out to try to solve a particular problem. So they're definitely more of the applied kind. Now, psychology, like all sciences, is empirical. You know, science, no matter what kind of science you're doing, you're obtaining your answers through making systematic observations. And when it comes to psychology, this can be difficult, unfortunately. It can be quite hard to find the cause of a human behavior because, as I like to say, humans are annoyingly complex. You know, there's so many factors that go into every little behavior that we perform, it can be exceptionally hard to try to predict that behavior. So if you compare psychology to other sciences, it's definitely one of the more complex ones. You know, when it comes to physics, we can usually describe the behavior of atoms and molecules and things like that, of basic, you know, of substances in the universe, in fairly simplistic ways. You know, we can use various kinds of formulae and mathematical equations to explain physics. When it comes to how, you know, collections of atoms and molecules and things like that work, you know, chemistry, now the explanations get a little bit more complicated and we can't use formulas so easily. When it gets to biology, this is just adding a whole new dimension. You know, we're getting really complicated at this point. And then psychology is even beyond that. So all I'm saying here is psychology is exceptionally difficult because there's so many factors that go into everything that we study. But in response to this, we have developed various research techniques to try to make things a little bit more simple. We've developed technologies such as fMRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging, to take all these other factors out of the picture and just look specifically at the biology, like what's going on in the biology of the brain. Another technique is electroencephalogram, or EEG. That's also been able to be used in order to study the biology of human thought and behavior. And then more recently, we've seen a lot of advancement in virtual reality. And this can help to eliminate a lot of those additional factors just by keeping things constant for every participant. So every participant experiences the situation in exactly the same way. So we need to develop these kinds of methods if we ever want to develop a complete understanding of human behavior. Another feature of psychology as a science is that it's a public thing. You know, like all sciences, our observations in psychology must be available for evaluation by others, because replication, you know, repeatability is key to science. This term replication, that just refers to repeating somebody else's research using the same basic procedures that were in the original study. And the intention of replication is to try to test the quality, the validity of that original study. So if you try to replicate somebody else's study and you fail to do so, maybe you messed up, or maybe that original study messed up. Like you start to get a sense that something wrong is happening here. But if you successfully replicate another researcher's study, it makes both of you look good. You know, that original study has more credibility now, and now you're associated with this discovery as well. Another one is psychology, like all sciences, is objective. You know, scientific results should not be skewed by biases, obviously. But psychology has a lot of additional potential for this kind of bias. Like, there's two ways that bias can affect the results of a psychological study. The first one is called researcher bias. So this refers to changes in a participant's behavior or changes in how data is handled, which is caused by the often unintentional influence of the researcher. So that last part is very important. It's typically unintentional. Researchers, you know, they develop their hypotheses and then they develop a method to test it, and then they collect their data, and they want their hypotheses to work out. You know, people want to be able to show that they can make good predictions. This is how scientists, you know, do their work. They want to be proven correct, to put it simply. So oftentimes those desires can have like a subconscious influence on their behavior, leading to a self-fulfilling prophecy. Now, the other source of bias comes from the participants themselves. And this is something we definitely do not see in other sciences. You know, a molecule doesn't care what you want to happen. A molecule doesn't care about your feelings. It's just going to behave how it behaves. But humans care. Humans naturally have empathy for one another. So when you get a participant in a laboratory and you start asking them to do things, they're going to start playing all kinds of head games and trying to figure out what you want them to do so that they can do it and be a good participant. This is why we sometimes call it the courtesy bias, because people just naturally want to be helpful. So if they can figure out what your hypothesis is, they'll help you to confirm it, which completely defeats the entire point of psychology as a science. Now, like all kinds of scientific research, we have to be concerned about ethical procedures. But compared to other sciences, psychologists need to be especially ethically minded. You can't traumatize a chemical. You can't hurt gravity, but you can hurt a person in your laboratory. And this particular subject has seen a lot of advancement in just the last 100 years, less than that, the last 80 years. there have been some pretty dark chapters in the history of psychology as a science. So what has been going on over the last, 80 so decades is the development of various ethics organizations leading to what we have today. Nowadays, we have the American Psychological Association, the APA, which has put out a series of guidelines, which I'll cover in another video, as to how researchers should interact with participants, how they should handle data, and so on. But when it comes to psychology as a science, the reason why I like it so much, the reason why I became a psychologist, is because psychology is not just learning about the world. Psychology is the science of you as an individual. You know, while other sciences look outward, attempting to understand how the universe works around us, psychology looks inward at the observer. So that's the observer observing themselves. So that common complaint that you hear from students whenever they take a course of, when will I ever need to know this information? Like, who needs to know trigonometry to be successful in life? Well, for some courses, that might actually be a valid complaint. You know, it's kind of hard to justify why you need to understand certain things. Even if it's fundamental concepts of physics or like particle physics or something like that, it's hard to see how that's going to be useful in your everyday life. But psychology doesn't have that problem. Every single thing that we learn in psychology applies to you directly. So if you plan to be a human, you should probably try to understand how humans work.